first came about in the 1890s.
The first film was shown in Paris in 1895 by the Lumières, and then it's the same year in New York by Edison. Edison showed a film the year before when it was only available to one viewer at a time. 1895 was the time when film was available to a larger audience. They were what was referred to as actualities. They tended to show actual events happening. So a very famous one was the Lumiere brothers showed their factory in Lyon with the gates opening as the workers went out for lunch, and the simple narrative finished with the gates closing. That was shown a number of other things, such as trains arriving at railway stations. Events that showed what was happening.
Film evolving out of photography, you've got, Edison, Thomas Edison, taking his Galloping Horse exhibition around, which was a series of photographs played in motion that looked like a horse was actually galloping. So I suppose you could look at it from there, and that's how kind of film has developed from photography. If you look at it today, you could look at the use of, say, digital SLRs to kind of shoot video on a photography piece of kit, essentially, shooting video.
Film evolving out of theatre. If you look at a lot of the techniques of film, especially in fiction production, where you've got things like the 180 degree rule, it essentially comes from the theatre. You know, the fourth wall is the audience. You could look at it like that. So, yeah.
Part of the 19th century, for the first time, presented images that could be captured, so that you could, particularly when you got onto negatives, you could keep an image. Prior to that, you had what was called a camera obscura, where you could get the shadows, but actually fixing it was difficult. So once you got the development of photography and the techniques to be able to keep an image, that was one thing. But then with the illusion of movement that the film camera gave, it allowed you to get that sense of a continuing story, or to seeing things in movement. So you have photographers like Edward Myerbridge in Britain, who show how people's bodies moved, how animals' bodies moved, and this was a revelation for people. And it was also used sort of scientifically as well, because, for instance, they were horses, they got a sense how horses moved when they cantered, that actually they kicked off on their back legs and moved diagonally. Prior to that, we all had this idea that these animals moved in very different ways. So it was used both sort of scientifically and to positively prove movement, but it was also used for entertainment and for other purposes. Oh. It was one of the art forms that really sort of predated cinema, but actually quite central to it, in as much as we've always retained the proscenium arch. When you go into a cinema, the screens are headed on. So it apes actually the architecture of what the theatre was like. And so that's continued really ever since.
I believe to have had a massive impact on film is the development in technology to put reels of film together, so that you can have a longer piece of film produced. So for example, instead of just having one reel, that's it. Filmmakers were able to edit together two different reels to create different pieces of thing, different pieces of film, and create a longer narrative.
I think it's difficult to say. I mean, in one sense you would say photography, but I think in another sense all these different modes of living, you know, a very changing sense of what it was like to live in the 19th century, with transport, with the rise of big cities. I think these all came together. But photography perhaps allowed you to capture those instances, to record them. So it's a mixture of things all coming together at the same time.
The early uses of film were primarily for entertainment. The people that had developed the technology and the people that had made it needed to make money somehow, so they went around and showcased that that spectacle that people have never seen before and made money from it. So entertainment value, yeah.
Well, up till the development of photography and film, painting was the way of recording events, particularly special events, portraits of famous people, things like Derby Day, the race course. You have to paint them before. With photography and with film, you can record them in other ways, so it allows you to actually see what was happening at that time.
Depending on how you look at it and the perspective that you take, if you look at the first film that was coloured in, you look in sort of late 1890s. If you look at the first film that was shot and then had a colour process put to it, you're looking at 1902, I think. If you want the first film shot in colour, you've got to look towards the 1920s. The first one that was shot and then given a colour, like a kind of colour to added to it, in its processing, was a film called, I think it's called The King and Queen, Our King and Queen Through India, from 1902, developed by the British.
Right, well, I mean, colour film started pretty soon after the origins of film. I think in 1902 you get it was patented, but it was mainly done through people painting on each plate. So each individual image would be hand painted, and it was sometime afterwards that you start to get colour film stock. I mean, obviously it was very incredibly time consuming for these artisans to have to paint individual frames. So when colour film started to come in and became economically viable to use, it was taken up by then a large film studio. So by the 1930s you've got companies such as MGM who were making very lavish films like Gone with the Wind or The Wizard of Oz, and one of the things they wanted to do was to show off colour. But colour goes right back to the origins of film, and there are historians who are investigating the importance of colour from the very first days.
No, I don't think so. You can get as much entertainment value out of watching, say, one of the Toy Story films as you can something that, say, it's meant to be, let's say, it's like Avatar. They've got them sort of original kind of features put in there, animated characters have got not much complexion in their skin. The audience knows that, therefore you kind of accept it that that's the case and it's fine, but you're still enjoying the story, because essentially that's what you're doing. You're getting entertained through a story, not the visualisation as much. It's kind of the story and the characters that go with it. So no, I don't think they should be.
I suppose it depends on the aesthetics of the piece that they're making. If you want to sort of present something like an animated film that has a feel of something older, then perhaps you might want to do that. But I suppose the point mentioned earlier was about how each art form moved towards what was intrinsic to it, so painting, sort of likeness, this argument was put forward. Then with film, I suppose you can argue about using what's inherent to the film medium. So on one hand, I can imagine people would say, yes, you would incorporate an equivalent of those. Others might say that you actually be inauthentic by doing that. So I think it depends on the filmmaker and what they aim to do with the piece they're making.
Yeah, I think that it could do that. It already does. There's a lot of experimental film that's done. That's used. So yeah, I think that it can.
I mean, I think that's a very big question, and it's a big aspect of the philosophy of the film. So even from the very early days, you get sort of two branches. You get theoreticians that say, André Bazin in France, that what film does is record reality. So that's what makes it unique. And so it's that sort of documentary mode that's important to them. But on the other hand, you've got people saying, like Sergei Eisenstein, so who argue that the film does something different, that you can, particularly through editing, through montage, you can sort of present a different view of the world. So I think those two very opposing views have all sort of run through filmmaking and theoretical approaches to it.
Again, the first one, the sort of invention of the camera, essentially, to start with, more than anything else, obviously. But then you've got, like I said earlier, you've got the sort of development of being able to, the editing process of being able to cut and paste film reels together to create a long piece of narrative. Then you've got the development of colour. So colour processes and then shooting in colour later on after that, but then you've got the advent of recording sound to go with a film and being played at the same time in the 20s, and then I'd say the development of CGI.
I suppose, technological or not, but I suppose one of the, the early films were 52 seconds worth of a camera that was in a fixed position. So I think when filmmakers started to realise about moving the camera and how you can edit, that enabled narrative, in a sense, to develop. But that's not the only way it could have gone, that's the way it predominantly has gone. So that's very important. I think sound, with the development of sound coming in 1927, had a huge impact. There were a lot of people at the time who would have preferred it to stay silent, and the film industry itself was reluctant to go into sound because of the costs, and they didn't think it added to the medium, but that was enormous. Colour stock. I think digital technology is enormous, and at the cusp of that now, we're just investigating what we can do with it. So that opens up whole new possibilities for film and where it might and where it might go.
Obviously, as human beings, we see things in colour. Therefore, in order to connect with somebody or something and feel emotion that you kind of meant to feel, or that a filmmaker wants you to feel, that can be enhanced with us seeing something that's meant to be reality. People's reactions to film when it was first developed in the 80s, sorry, 90s, if you look at that early Lumiere film, The Ride of the Train, it said that people in the audience ran out of the way because they thought the train was going to come through the screen that it was being projected onto. That said it all to me. Yeah, it's a massive impact. And again, you look at it now, the development of it, it's amazing how you can connect with something on screen emotionally and be taken in by it. It is the development and the technology of film, expensive. If you look at people who funded the development of colour, people like Technicolour, and there's another British pair that kind of developed colour processing that were patented by them. They had backers, like big backers. You look at other types of equipment and things like that. It is expensive, but that was then delivered to the masses in various forms, in various ways, early on and throughout the rest of time. So
so that everybody can afford to go and watch the cinema, therefore can make more and more money. So, yes or no? Yes and no.